welcome back to this charming Smithscast with the handsome hooligans. The handsome hooligans, Mark, Steve, Kaz. We are three songs into Hatful of Hollow, and we're going to talk about it a little more, starting with a great one, This Charming Man.
Yeah, we talked about This Charming Man on their hippopotamus. I won't stop, man. No, on their eponymous named album.
Just call it the debut.
I know. I want to sound smart. The hippopotamously named album. Okay. Anyway, so we talked about it, but this version's better.
This version is better.
We talk. Is this the one that's actually?
I don't know if this version is better, but it's certainly
okay.
Different.
Okay. Let's here. Let me listen to the bass though. That's a bit. Oh yeah, I got some stuff to talk about here. Oh. Yeah, this version's way better than the other one.
What about the New York version?
No,
New York, baby. We already did that.
No, but so like, when I first started listening to the Smiths, I really just listened to this album, and everybody was like, oh man, This Charming Man is so good, and I just couldn't get into it. And then I listened to the actual single version, and I was like, holy crap, this is great.
The single version?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe, are you're listening to This Charming Man, New York? The one that you got into?
New York, baby.
That cowbell.
What's
that
the other
cowbell.
One? What's the other one? Manchester?
Manchester.
Wait, do you have the...
Yeah, I have the other one, but I'm seeing if I have one.
I mean,
we don't want some weird one. Yeah, let's just hear... I want to hear the difference.
It's
on... Original single version, right there at the very bottom.
This is the one you want?
Yeah.
Okay, well there is a huge division in the and the only way which version do you like better, Steve?
I think the only way to settle it
wait well look you got the Peel session right there, so that's the one we can listen to. Okay, so I'm for the Peel session. He's for the single version. You're for the New York. Hey, forget about it.
You know the only way we can settle this?
Paper, rock, scissors.
No,
okay.
I was gonna say Monday Night Raw.
Monday Night Raw.
Paper, rock.
Yes. I guess the Peel version is better.
And this is Peel version.
You know what?
Inspired.
Okay, pause real quick.
Home field advantage.
You know what, actually, I can see the benefit or the pluses of both of them.
Yeah.
You know, it's just I think for me, the original single version, and that's actually the one that's on the album.
Uh-huh.
The first album. Mm-hmm. We'll call it the first album.
Yeah.
Is just a little too faster. I like this one because it's slower. It's like doom, 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 doom. Boom, boom.
Yep.
I love the bit. I mean, the. And you can. So it just reminds me of kind of like this. Not funk, but.
Yeah.
This
honestly, this one reminds me of more of like 60s girl pop stuff.
Yeah, it's kind of like with a guy with a deep voice playing the bass, you know, like. Boom, boom. I love that.
Yeah.
Like, so. Here, I want to. You got to go. Oh, wait. My notes. I wrote down actual notes.
Okay.
Go to number two. No, on this same song, go to 2 minutes and 28 seconds. And I wrote, okay. Sweet bass.
So 2 minutes.
That's how you know.
What is it? 2 minutes and
28 seconds. I think.
I can't wait till we get.
That's like the end of the song.
I know, but.
Okay, so we're at 2:24.
So yeah, just play.
So we'll start here.
Okay, here it is. It's like this. It's not all over the place. But listen, he's off.
Slap it.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's this cool walking bass line, like boom, 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 boom. So to me, I guess the reason I like this version so much is it's got that cool bass that's kind of like, you're like, yeah, man. Like, you imagine being in some kind of a blues or some kind of bar, you know, with a drink, you know, like, yeah, man.
I can't wait until we get to, like, another really bass-driven track, and Mark brings out his notes, and, like, in big letters, it's like, Funkalicious.
Funkalicious.
You guys want Funkalicious? We got Funkalicious here.
We do?
Uh-huh.
Let's
stick with the Smiths.
Yeah, I mean...
No, so anyway, that's one thing that I really like about
This Charming Man,
but also Andy Rourke on bass.
Yeah.
He was way into funk.
Yeah.
He actually was. And so Johnny Marr was influenced by funk too. So, I mean, they take the bass in a different way. It's kind of like, actually, speaking of Duran Duran, they had kind of a disco-y, funky bass.
Yeah.
You know, so, and the Smiths do it as well, but it's not as pointed out to.
Sometimes I would like to hear versions of these songs with like a fretless bass, because Andy Rourke also had a fretless bass,
you
but I don't think he ever used it in the Smiths.
You don't want to know what a good funkadelic is?
He's been looking the whole time.
I have
like, we, me and you have been talking, Steve's like, where's this song?
Listen.
Call this funk.
You want to hear some funk?
There's
hey, get the funk out.
Listen.
Get the funk out. You want to hear some... Man.
This is my favorite one. Is this my, in this one, Sleeper?
Sleeper. It's
yeah,
basically...
Yeah.
Hey,
Bondi,
you want to hear some funk?
No.
Here you go. And this is Johnny Marr's kind of funk.
Okay.
You ready? Shoot, where's it at? It's coming. Shoot, it's coming eventually.
What a long intro!
I'm sorry, Mark, we're gonna have to stop you copyright purposes, so...
Holy crap, this intro is so long. Listen to that bass, though.
Yeah.
I mean, that bass is cool. This is actually Bohannon.
Oh. Have you ever listened to Japan? The band from Japan.
Big in Japan?
No. There's a band called Japan, and Andy Rourke was really into them, and they were more like Duran Duran, like the 70s.
Yeah.
And they had a really cool bassist, McCarn. He only ever played fretless bass, and it's some of the coolest bass you'll hear.
Well, see, I'm saying, the Smiths bass lines... sometimes they're a lot more like that.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like, and nobody ever points that out though, except for me. Am I the only one? But the reason that Johnny Marr wanted Andy Rourke was because they had played together before, and he knew he was very good at bass, and that he could do kind of the funk and that kind of
stuff.
You
know, Andy Rourke actually wrote one of my favorite B-sides.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. The Girl
yeah.
Least Likely. Yeah, I was like, what?
Me too, me too,
yeah.
Yeah, I was like, oh my God, because, yeah, I was reading the inside of the CD and I was like, wait, Andy Rourke wrote the music for that?
Yeah, I think he also wrote either November Spawn a Monster or Interesting Drug.
No, he played on it.
He didn't write on it.
What's
his name, Parisi?
Yeah, I don't think so, but better try next time, I guess. No.
I'm looking it up.
Okay.
No, but he did, I was surprised. Okay, so This Charming Man, we have already talked about it.
Okay.
You know, Morrissey's bowel problems and stuff. So anyway, but I'm just saying, like, nobody ever says... They're like, these, all four of them are so good at what they do.
Yes.
And that's one thing that irks me is that they should have at least given the other guys 15%. But anyway.
Well.
25%? No. Okay, I get it. But 16%. each.
16? 20%,
we're negotiating. 17.
20% would have been okay.
18.
Okay, like, when
are you trying to?
We're like, I keep going up. Okay, 50% for my.
Who writes the songs?
I know.
It's not just Johnny Marr writing everything.
No, I'm totally with you.
I mean,
yeah, that's what I'm
Joyce
saying.
Comes
I go
with the drum beats. It's not Marr sitting there at the drum beats saying,
"Yeah,
okay,
I know."
Joyce, watch what I'm doing here.
No, and they actually talk about
yeah.
it and the thing. So I'm like, okay, well, 10% was a little bit low ball, you
yeah.
know, for these for each of them. I mean, and you guys get 40%. You're not doing everything, but 15% would be a you know a little better.
Yes, and talking about that, The Cure with Robert Smith. He made it a flat out rule that whoever played on the album got writing credits for the song. Period.
Oh really?
Yeah. So if you were just playing tambourine, you got credit for writing the song.
I mean, I understand Morrissey and Marr, you know, were having to do all this stuff with touring and all this crap, you know. So but I'm just saying, for just the album stuff, you know, you don't. That's just I don't agree total 25%, but I don't agree 10%.
Yeah, I don't think it was an equal partnership.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I think Morrissey and Marr took on the heavier burden, so they
yeah.
should get a heavier percentage. But Joyce and Work didn't just
yeah they were contributing
on everything.
Yeah.
So apparently Andy Rourke wrote. Yes, I am blind. Girl, least likely to, and get off the stage.
Yep.
Oh, get off the stage. Did he play the accordion for that? That song.
I love
off
that song.
The stage.
I love that song. I want to send it to Morrissey and say, "Hey, remember you wrote this."
How about you take your own advice,
yeah.
dude?
I think
yeah.
your time has come.
But this is again the Friends of Mike Joyce and Morrissey podcast.
Yeah.
Anytime we ever. We ever badmouths one of the members, we had to, you know, we're the friends of, anyway, so, wait, we're on, we just did This Charming Man.
Now we get
now,
to the best Smith song, probably the best song ever in existence.
This is, yeah, this is the most known Smith song.
Let's see if they can,
it
if
is.
They can figure this out.
Please, is pretty known, Dan.
I would say, actually, There's a Light. That's really well known because it circulated so long for like an indie masterpiece, you know.
Well, I know, but I'm saying if a radio is gonna play a Smith song,
yep, it's more than likely this one.
Yeah,
and this is my most favorite, and I think it's the best overall.
Okay.
And let's just play it, and nobody say anything, and let's just let it go through.
I'm the sun, I'm the air. I'll shine as much as tomorrow.
And I'm just going to pause it there. Anybody who said this was hippie chicks,
no,
leave this page right now.
Yeah, they sued hippie, whatever that.
Yeah,
there's a song called Hippie Chick.
Yeah.
And they started out.
Yeah, they
sampled
this
exact,
without permission.
Yeah, the exact. So every time that would come on the radio, you're like, all right, the Smiths. All of a sudden, no, hippie chick. You're like,
oh. I thought you were going to say, all right, hippie chick. And then,
yeah. Oh, it's the Smiths again.
Smiths.
Like, all of a sudden, you're listening to Hatful of Hollow after these things. What? Hippie chick? Sweet. Oh, the Smiths. That's funny, man.
Yeah, I just think this is a brilliant song. And from... What?
What?
Nothing. I'm just further business developments.
We're cutting you out, Steve. You're out of here.
Oh, man.
No.
This is now the hippie chicks podcast.
We're now the hippie chicks.
Anyway, I love this, and I read somewhere, and I can't remember if I'm just not remembering this correctly, but the reason they didn't really play this in concert is because it was so freaking hard to play.
Yeah,
yeah.
That they just wouldn't play it in concerts.
Well, it was so hard for them to be able to get that sound. They had two speakers going or sending it through two things, and so they had to keep on. And then they, whenever it stopped sounding, they'd have to. Anyway,
I love it.
I mean,
the music is brilliant in this. The lyrics are not overbearing and they're not long.
No, they're simple to the point.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, hey, you're going out. I mean, I remember, though, this song really spoke to me because it's just like, you know, you'd have those nights where, like, you know, you go somewhere and you're hoping and you're looking around, hoping to find somebody, you know, and you just go home alone.
Yeah.
Yep. Kaz, what about
story
you?
Of my life.
Same.
Back when you were a kid?
Yeah, back when I was a kid. No, I just...
Many years ago!
I just remember... I kind of relate this song to one of my friends when we lived in Utah, and how he would always be like, alright, let's go out, let's have a great time, when you'll find someone, and it'll be great. And then I'd always see him, like... trying to flirt it up with everyone, no one would ever talk to me, and I
wait, so he gets the girl?
No, just girls? Like, it was very obvious, like, oh, he wanted to go out for himself, he didn't really care about my well-being, he was just saying, hey, you should come, but...
I don't think so. I mean, I knew your friends, they weren't all... I mean, my friends were the same, Mark was the same way with me, both of the Marks were the same way with me. They'd say, hey, Steven, let's go out tonight, and we'd go out. And they'd go off on their own, and they'd get all these girls, and I'd be
sitting
back crying my head off because...
Crying your head off. See, boy, he always had so many of his dating.
But I don't know.
I did
it's
not.
It's not. Come on.
I did not.
Anyway, but I'm just saying that I relate to it. It's a song that a lot of people can, you know, it's just like, you know, go out and, you know, what is it? I'm human and I need to be loved. I mean, come on. Who doesn't need to be loved? Or who doesn't... Even the worst person in the world, you know, wants to be loved.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think in the Italian pressing of William, it has this song. And I was listening to it, like, a few months ago, and I was like, this is so good. I can't believe I don't listen to this more often. And then, like, 1 minute from the end, it's just, like, a voice like, okay? And then the music cuts off, and then it slowly fades back in, and I was like, that was really dumb. Like, that was so dumb.
What?
I don't think it's dumb at all. It's right around.
Wait, the song? Or on this Italian pressing?
On the Italian pressing.
Oh, okay. He's talking about...
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
And you know what? That's the thing, is that it's one of the Smiths' longest songs that coming in at... It is 6 minutes and 45 seconds, but it doesn't get tiring. You know, it's pretty cool because just that... I think it's, to me, Blue Monday by New Order.
Yeah.
It's basically, this is the Smiths' Blue Monday. That song that, actually, they never had another song that sounded like this at all, you know?
Yeah.
And that was, and it's like New Order, Blue Monday. That was one of the hugest songs. One of their hugest songs, but they never really had any other song that sounded like that.
I mean, there was one song on Power Corruption and Lies that sounds so much.
Oh my God! Well, no, that's not Power. That's just the same song, man.
Yeah,
it's with no lyrics, I think.
Pretty much.
Yeah, because Power Corruption and Lies is where they originally had it.
No, because it wasn't on Power Corruption and Lies, and that's why they had it on here.
No, Blue Monday.
No. This is the American version.
Oh.
In England, they didn't have it.
Oh,
in the iTunes original, actually, they talk about that.
Anyway, okay, so, well, they, but this is the Blue Monday of New Order, of
the Smiths,
it's that song where you're like, where Steve is like, what the heck is this song? This song's so good, and all of a sudden, boom, they hook you.
Yeah.
Really, you in?
But honestly, curse to Jeff Travis for not instantly recognizing this as like the hit that it was. Like,
oh yeah,
it's not really you guys. You
he's
know,
like, what's Johnny trying to do?
Well, he put it on B side.
Yeah,
and then it got more play than the A side, And so they said, well, let's release it as a single.
Yeah, but...
And nobody bought it because they already had it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, Jeff Travis wasn't the best guy, but
oh,
whatever.
Oh, actually, I have one of the weird American pressings of this single.
That is a weird one, man.
Yeah.
From the Sire album.
Yeah, but like...
I mean, his murder...
It's
Morrissey's turning over in his grave right now.
Yeah, but
knowing
like,
that
it's
they put
Sire and everything.
And so is Johnny Marr.
But yeah, it's really weird.
Because they're...
Wow, somebody put him in a grave already, huh? Well, they might not be happy about it. That's probably why they're rolling around in their grave.
It's a shallow grave, so they can get out. No, but yeah, this is like the song that... You know, I mean, it's a good club song. You can play it. You know, this is just one that... It's like Blue Monday. So.
I agree.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree.
That's easy. And he's got the... I mean, but Johnny talking about, like, how it came together. He's, like, kind of the psychedelic thing. And then,
yeah.
But then he started adding stuff like the slide guitar
yeah.
and stuff. Really cool. So he did, you know, kind of a this dark... It really... It's kind of a dark song.
Yeah, what was the demo title? Like, Swampy?
Oh, yeah. He's like, bluesy, or yeah, Swampy Blues or something. Or
yeah, something
some,
like that. Because
there was Waltz, Waltzy.
Which was...
William It Was Really Nothing was like Happy or...
Yeah.
Or something like... And so, yeah, so there's the three songs. Anyway, so... Okay, so now on to a curious Smith song. I think this band just, they were so lucky to all come together.
You're right, but this song here, I have a problem with this version here, because the drums are so loud, the guitar is so loud, but the voice is really low.
Not too low.
Yeah, it's being overpowered by the instruments. And it's not even the lead guitar that's overpowering them. That's the problem.
Oh, it's the bass and the
yeah.
drums.
Yeah.
I like that up front. But, you know, just turn Morrissey off.
No.
No, I'm just joking. I can see what you're saying.
This was the only single I didn't have, by the way.
This wasn't a single.
Well, it was
a
B-side.
Was,
yeah.
Yeah,
all
right.
But there was the version, the thing that was on there was a live...
Wait,
yeah.
Handsome Devil, no, it was, yeah, remember we talked about it. It was Hand and Glove, and the other side was the live version of...
Oh, yes.
Oh, do you have it?
Hand and Glove.
Do you have the live version that's on the first single? You probably do in the rarities.
Let's see. Hand and Glove.
But one of my favorite things that I've ever learned about this is that Johnny said that when he wrote it, he was trying to make the guitars sound like they were having an argument with each other. So, like, the bong... Bom 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 bom. It's like kind of like, hey, listen, here, come on, you know, and the yeah. It's like just yelling. I don't know.
I remember
it's really cool.
When he wrote it, he's like, I made a mental note, I'm gonna make more of these. That's what he says in the book.
Yeah.
So yeah, and he never really did though. He never did
Yeah.
You're right.
It's kind of this.
That I didn't have.
Oh, yeah, that's because Handsome Devil was the B side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
There were only, like, what, 500 copies of Handsome
Devil?
Well,
there's only a.
No.
There was only a 7 inch of it, though.
Yeah.
No, there's lots of copies. You can still get them.
Yeah.
I mean,
they have it.
There's a certain pressing where, like, the thing, you know, there's, like, ones that are rare printed
yeah.
out of somewhere. Anyway.
Like more.
But you can get it for
actually,
$30.
Actually, speaking of that, and we already covered this in one
yeah,
of the earlier
I had
ones.
It.
Didn't you have both versions of William? I think that's the one. What was that the one where Morrissey had to redo the cover of himself holding a glass of milk?
Yeah, I have that. I swear.
What difference does
yeah,
it make?
Yeah,
yeah. So Mark used to have both of those. He used to have the one with Zod on the front. And
well, what happened was, okay, they... I mean, we're getting off into it, but that was what difference does it make?
Yeah.
Yeah. First they released the one with... What's his name?
He played Zod in the original Superman.
Oh, gosh dang it, from the collector.
Yeah.
Anyway, him on the cover, and then he didn't approve it of it.
Yeah.
And then so they replaced it with the Morrissey one.
Yep.
And then he recanted, and he's like, okay, you guys can.
Yeah.
And then so they put it out again with him on it.
Yeah, but you had both versions, the one with him and the one with Morrissey.
The original one didn't even have the Smiths written on it.
Yeah.
So if that one's like super rare.
Yeah.
What is his name? Gosh dang it.
Kaz, what's his name?
The guy from the collector.
Yeah, Terrence Stamp.
Terrence Stamp. That's right. So anyway, this song's really interesting
because it's Star Wars by
this song is very sexual.
He was the Chancellor. You
know? Yeah.
I mean,
what do you think this song's about?
Oh man, it's kind of this. It's almost like a gender bending kind of, like not necessarily like, okay, I don't want to be like
lyrics?
Dirty, but
what do the lyrics say?
Okay, yeah. Let's
do you have any notes for this?
My only notes is I'm gonna make more of these. No, all the streets are crammed with things. Eager to be held. Oh, I always thought it. He said, "You've got to be held." Anyway, jeez, I need to read these lyrics. I know what hands are for, and I like to help myself. Ooh, you naughty boy. you asked me the time, but I sent something more, and I would like to give you what you're asking for. I always thought he said, "I would like to give you what you came for."
Well, to me,
what song have you been listening to?
This one, but like I said,
to me it sounds.
Okay, I'm going to tell you what I thought.
Okay, go ahead.
No, after you. Okay.
You go first.
Okay. So, like, okay. These are things that Morrissey would never do, first off. Like, he's all like, he asked somebody, hey, what time it is? Or is it?
But I sent something more.
Yeah, I sent something more, and I'm going to give you what I came for. You know, like, this is not that Morrissey's personality type. And then he's cracking a whip and you skip, but you deserve it, you know, you're naughty. And then let me get my hands on your mammary glands. Anyway, it's just so like,
yeah.
Like first off, he's calling them mammary glands. So he's never had his hands on them because, you know, that's like the technical term, you know, like the doctor's term, you know, it's so at the end he talks about, there's more to life than books, you know, but not much more. I think this is all a fantasy that he's reading about. You know, some kind of a sexual, like, something of Capricorn or whatever that... What was that? The dirty book in the 60s? You know what I'm talking about? So this is like a fantasy. This isn't actually... this song. I mean, because he's calling them mammary glands.
Yeah.
So,
it rhymes.
What do you think this song is about?
Yeah.
Male prostitution from the point of a John. That's what I think this song is about.
Okay.
You asked me the time. So prostitutes are guys for like, hey, you got the time?
Steve, you're so dirty. This guy, how do you live with that? You're always making the Smiths so dirty.
But that's what, well.
No, I'm just joking. No, that's interesting. Okay, keep going.
Because the thing is, he wrote another song when he was when he became a solo artist called Piccadilly Polari, which is completely about the male prostitutes that hang around Piccadilly Square. That's what that entire song is about, is male prostitution. I think this one is his first attempt at that, which was better than Piccadilly Polari, by the way, but this song is...
Yeah, but
what's he
talking about? Let me get my hands on your mammary glands.
He's
making rhymes?
No, I think he's trying to project, and it could be transvestite prostitutes too.
Well, I know, but I'm saying it's kind of this gender bending one.
Yeah,
it's like okay, well, who's when you're in your scholarly room, yeah, who will swallow whom?
Yeah.
Exactly.
I mean,
exactly.
So it's just like,
And you know, and they've actually done a few studies on this. The people who are actually using these male prostitutes are usually the highly respected people of society that want to keep this quiet. So in your scholarly room, undoubtedly, a very well-respected professor or even, because you know,
even
Morrissey's,
a politician.
Yeah, because Morrissey's love of politics.
Oh my God.
So it's
I'm like, you know, listeners think, I'm like, you need to be a Ron Paul supporter. Like, you should be libertarian because he's all complaining about all these restrictions and stuff.
Well, that's what I see the song as, is male prostitution.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh my gosh. I always thought it was just kind of some, like, sexual thing, but not necessarily for, but yes,
you
me
see
the time.
This as like being like,
like, just kind of like, I mean, I always, yeah, I just thought it was just a sexual song, you know, and it's kind of like, you know, going, not necessarily for, you know, women or men,
yeah.
You know, it just kind of mixes the two.
Yeah.
And, but I never thought of it in such lewd, disgusting terms.
I mean, it's about the daffodils and dandelions.
It's dandelions.
Mark doesn't listen to the lyrics anyway, so I mean...
No, I do, but I think it's just, I never sat down and, like, read them and was like, you know, because I would just kind of make up my own story with them. And,
I guess.
Yeah.
I don't know. The way I've always seen this song is, like, it's about a school teacher who is kind of like, hey, listen, if you do something for me, I'll help you get through your exams, you know?
Oh.
Like, because
ooh, we just
Morrissey,
watched Law and Order about this, too.
Yeah, because, like, Morrissey is, you know, he's known for being, like, school absolutely sucked and all the teachers were out to get you. A lot of people are like,
well,
no,
this
song
in,
definitely
in the,
is about
in the
that.
He was.
Yeah.
Wait, you're talking, wait, don't jump ahead. That's meat is murder. Come on.
No. I know, but in the Smiths he was, but... Once he got into the school,
yeah. Now teachers
quit.
Are afraid of their students.
Yeah.
Yeah. I whenever I heard about this song, I was like, "What, dude? Morrissey, you can't have it both ways."
Yeah.
Anyway,
yeah. No.
But so you're like, man, you're really
yeah, can I say those lyrics?
Making it bad.
No,
like,
yeah, that's
prostitution
just,
was bad, but
that's
now
just the way I've always viewed it.
Man.
But like, even
when
the,
you're
even
solidly
the line. Where is it?
I cracked the whip.
No.
Can you skip?
You asked me the time, but I sent something more. Like, I can totally see, like, in a schoolroom setting, just, like, a student asking what the time is, and the teacher being like, I know what you want. Or, like...
I know what you want.
Yeah, or, like, what's the last line in there?
There's more life than books you know, but not much more.
Yeah. I feel like...
See,
I feel like that's like the teacher or professor or whatever being like, there's more to life than books, like referring to like his sex life or whatever. But then also being like, but not much more, because like come back.
It's just books.
Well, see,
yeah.
that's where I was going. That's where I was thinking, I mean, and actually that's just a recent thought I had about that actually this is all kind of just a fantasy. You know, that more some kind of fantasy book he's reading and he's just, like, getting caught up in it.
Yeah.
Kind of getting lost. Yeah, like, you know, he's being that character that's, like, ooh, like 50 Shades of Grey guy, you know. Ooh, I'm Jack Grey or whatever he is. You know, like, doing all these kinky things and stuff. But something that Morrissey would never do, like, hey, what time is it? Or this, you know, and also, ooh, I know what you want and I'm going to give it to you. Psh.
Yeah.
So cheesy. So funny.
Nope.
But
so
anyway...
That's my take on this.
But
song.
It's definitely an
that's
interesting song.
That's
that
a
is a good take. Yeah. Man. We all have different opinions.
We do.
Who's right?
I am.
One thing I'm wrong.
Actually, I really liked your explanation. I mean, and Kaz's. Yours and Kaz's.
Oh,
I thought
you were going to say my reason, or how to resolve this. Like... I'm just gonna say,
wrestling.
Anytime you guys want to wrestle, meet me in the ring, okay?
In the ring,
we'll
man.
Have,
no,
we'll
in
have,
the cage.
We'll have Ultimate.
In the cage match.
We'll have Ultimate Warrior there, and
the Ultimate Warrior. Are we going to heaven or something?
Yeah.
Dead.
Yes.
We'll have all the dead wrestlers there.
Yeah, Andre the Giant.
Oh yeah.
Ooh.
So anyway, this is like the Smiths' most like blatantly sexual song.
Yeah.
And
are you sure?
Blatantly
sexual.
It's probably not the 15 most 15
minutes
sexual.
With you, you know, is like, okay.
Yeah.
So you don't want to talk about the next one?
Hand in glove. No, this one actually mentions memory glands.
Oh.
And just cracking a whip. No, this one, I think, and then they stopped singing this one.
Well,
35
I mean,
minutes already? Jeez. We can't win. Let's just do one more. Hand
do
and
one
glove.
More.
Or wait, we've already done Hand and Glove, except for we don't... Let's just hear this version. This one's a better
okay.
version. It's got to fade in. See,
this
actually,
is actually this is a single version, actually, I believe.
Yeah. You might be, you could be, yeah, because just that faded and stuff.
Yeah.
And what was the problem with the one on, was it overproduced on the first album?
Yeah, it was just
what did we say, where it was like, gosh, man, they just did too much with it.
Yeah, they tried to make it too...
Wait,
too
is that the one
that...
That's still...
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Off. There we go. But I'm just saying, you know what I really like, and I'm noticing it, and you pointed out, because you don't like it necessarily, is that the bass is so much turned up on this one.
Yeah.
I love
yeah.
that.
No, yeah, I'm not saying I'm against the bass. I love the bass. Just
it's all about that bass.
It's just very interesting. I really like this one, actually. And I can't remember where I read it, but I remember someone saying that having a fade-in for Hand in Glove was, like, a very risky and, like, very, like... I don't know. It was, like, a statement, almost. Like, because it made it hard for radio DJs to introduce the song.
Coming right up, it's Hand in Glove!
And then, you know, it starts off very...
Yeah,
small,
like that weird fate, yeah. Well, fortunately, they never got any airplay anyway, so...
Yeah, hang the DJ.
Alright, so, are we going to end this one?
Yeah, we probably
hang
should.
Hang it, man.
It's already
seems like we're doing
minutes.
Them so short. Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Holy crap. Okay. Guys, this has been episode 2 of Hatful of Hollow.
Yep.
Part.
What are you trying to say?
Four or five part series. I don't even know.
I'm not sure when this
like,
will be done.
Yeah, this will never end. So, thanks for joining the Handsome Hooligans. And if you have any comments or disagreements or agreements, like on all my points, if you
or
want to.
Or if you have
me.
A different idea of what the song was about, mention it in the comments and we'll bring it up on the next one.
Yeah.
Or if.
Oh, we need to do a shout out next
yeah,
time.
Yeah, we'll give you
because somebody
well,
commented.
We'll give you a shout.
Somebody did comment.
Another
Ooh,
person?
Another Let's
person.
Just say it's blowing up, man. We got another
comments.
Comment.
Yes!
Yes! Yeah, so it's going viral. No big deal. Something we do. So we're... okay, so let's end this. You're going to end it with Flight of the Conchords.
Yep.
Oh my God. She's so hot.
Here, turn it down.
She's so flippin' hot.
What?
She's like a curve.
Flippin' hot.
He said flippin'?
I want to tell her how hot she is, but she'll think I'm being sexist.
Sexist.
She's so hot.
I like the way they say it. She'll think I'm being sexist.
Bitch.